Normally, my videos are pretty abstract. While I might talk about a question answering system, it doesn't help you if you actually want to make something. This video is about the series of homeworks that I use in my undergraduate course at the University of Maryland that will get you up and running if you want to make a system that answers questions. Now, unlike most of my other videos, this is mostly about the plumbing of how everything works. We won't talk about the math or the concepts. That's by design. You should try your own stuff and see how it works. Will it be the best in the world? No. Will it be efficient? Also no. Will it work? Yeah, most of the time. And it can come close to folks who are actually pretty good at trivia. You can take a look at our last matchup from the course, link in the description. This system is designed to answer quiz bowl questions, the highest and correct form of question answering. Before we get into the individual steps, let's talk about the big picture. We break things down into two stages, guessing and buzzing. These are the words I use in my code, so I'm going to keep using them. I've been at this for over a decade now, and now other whippersnappers call these steps other things like reading, re-ranking, abstaining, but I'm going to stick with my words because I was here first and I don't want to change my code. Okay, so let's see the big picture. A question comes in. The guesser finds evidence that points to an answer, and the buzzer decides whether to take that guess as the right answer or not. Simple, right? Let's fix that and make it a little bit more complicated. First, in Quiz Bowl, the Quiz Board of Kings, you don't just get a single question. You can interrupt the question at any time. So there's another component in the picture, the moderator, which feeds in the question bit by bit. So a big part of this process is how to get information from the moderator into the question answering system. So let's drill down into each of these and look at some code. Let's first take a look at the guesser. As you can see, it's the first thing to interact with the question. So it needs to take the question as input and then output some guesses. So this is encoded as a Python function, as is everything else. So the questions come in as a list of strings, and the guesses come out as a list of lists where each item is a tuple of the guess and the score. The optional argument is how many guesses you should output as the guesser. Obviously, you need to give at least one, but we'll see in a second why it's better to have several guesses to pick from. Throughout, I'm going to mention ways that you could make the system better. To be clear, everything in these red boxes are not required to get a system up and running or to get a good grade on my homework, but it's something to think about if you're looking for a project that will do better than the baseline. My advice would be not to do any of this until you get an end-to-end system working. That being said, let's talk about how you could make it better. Many modern question answering systems explicitly use evidence. So you could add that by also returning the context of the matched questions. So if the answer is Caprivi, you could give the text of why you're guessing Caprivi. For example, the panhandle of Namibia is named after a German politician. One very specific way of doing this is returning the most important words, for example, the biggest contributors to the cosine score. Another idea is doing something like replacing TF-IDF with dense retrieval. So let's see this in action. We first fire up the guesser with some training data. This takes a while, be patient. Whew. When you run idfguesser.py, you first see the confusion matrix, which shows where you're getting stuff wrong. For example, you can see that sometimes it confuses specific with general names or screws up the entity type. Then we ask it to generate five guesses on the question, what Illinois senator born in Kentucky was president during the US Civil War? Look at that! Abraham Lincoln is the top guess. As I said, this isn't going to be perfect. The wrong answer is ranked number two, and the score is only slightly lower than Abraham Lincoln. But you can also see how creating a buzzer that, for example, notices that Abraham Lincoln appears twice in the list of guesses might help you out to know that, hey, yeah, maybe actually the answer is Abraham Lincoln. So how is it able to make a guess? Everything that we're doing feeds on data. So this needs to be trained somehow. Let's take a look at another piece of code where we train the guesser. You'll notice that what's being fed in is an object called a quanta database. From that, we can get the questions and the answers. We'll create a TF-IDF vector for each question and store them in a database. Your guess function will then later look through it, find the closest vector, and return the corresponding answer. What's this quanta database thing? This is basically a bunch of old quiz bowl questions. Eventually, you'll want to pay more attention to the data, but for the moment, you can just let us handle the details. When you're ready, take a look at the quanta util folder to see what it's doing. This is probably one of the easiest ways to improve your accuracy. Add more data. Two obvious places to get more data are Wikipedia and Project Gutenberg. But this is also a place to be creative. Think about other sources that you could use, particularly where your system isn't doing as well. But if you do that, you'll need to make sure that your API is consistent with the one we have for the quanta database. This is important, but straightforward. You basically need to line up your answers with the answers used in our data. Let's move on from the guesser to the buzzer. In some ways, the buzzer is conceptually really simple. It's just adding a Boolean to the output of the guesser. And that's where you should start. Just start with a static threshold that you tune. So that's where you should start, but you should very quickly move on to other stuff. That isn't the best way to do it. You need to really train your buzzer to do well. So where do you get data to train your buzzer? This gets generated by your guesser. And we have code to generate training data for your buzzer in tfidfguesser.py. And when you're training your buzzer, instead of just using some silly threshold, you could do things like per category threshold, or tune the threshold based on the length of the question, or use the dynamics of the guesses, how the guesses change as you get more information, or look at the constellation of guesses like we saw in the Abraham Lincoln example. Here's the code that actually generates guesses from whatever the guesser in TF-IDF guesser is, and you'll be using that later to do feature engineering to decide when to trust the output of your guesses. There's also an example of what that output looks like in the data directory, where it's called buzztrain.jsonl. The jsonl extension means that it's one JSON object per line. Let's take a look at the data. These are the predictions of a guesser. This is the data you'll use in the feature engineering homework to build a buzzer. The big idea of that homework is to create a classifier that will do a better job of figuring out which guesses are right or not. In other words, a buzzer. And here's the code that will take those guesses and use it as training data. This is probably the part of the task that requires the most creativity. One high-level piece of advice is not to think about individual guesses. How likely is the answer to this question Midnight's Children? That's not the right way to think about it. The way to think about it is, if I have three guesses of Midnight's Children and one guess of Salman Rushdie, how likely is it that I think the answer is Midnight's Children? In other words, use the constellation of guesses to figure out what to answer. This is why it's good to get more than the top one guess out of the guesser. Another piece of advice is that many questions are similar. Create features that generalize across questions. Does the answer match the answer type specified by the question? For example, if the question says that it's looking for a British author and you return a Spanish book, you don't need much knowledge to know that that's wrong. Or for another example, if the question asks when was the Battle of Hastings, you don't want to answer Winston Churchill. You want to answer something that looks like a date. Now, you may think that this is just quiz bowl weirdness with waiting after each word to decide whether or not to buzz, and it's not. Recently, other question answering leaderboards and competitions have been focusing on the problem of abstaining, not giving an answer when otherwise there would be a wrong answer if the system is confused. This has always been front and center of quiz bowl, and it's now a part of Squad 2.0 and Natural Questions. Glad that they're catching up. We do encourage you to think about this as two separate problems rather than trying to do everything at once. This makes splitting your data set a little more difficult than traditional machine learning applications. Now, you could, if you wanted, treat this as a straightforward train dev test split. You could build models on train, see if they're good on dev, and only report final model output on test. But to prevent overfitting, we split things up for you to make your life easier. You train a guesser on guess train, evaluate tune that guesser on guess dev, then apply that good guesser to create data which becomes training data for the buzzer or buzz train, which you can tune and evaluate on buzz dev and so on. This is our suggestion once you get into a mode of heavy iteration. Otherwise, you might be overfitting on your training data and not generalizing so well. The only thing that we haven't talked about is how this fits in with the moderator. For homeworks, we'll use Gradescope, which is relatively straightforward. We'll just call your function's code directly, so we'll do the hard work of interacting with the moderator. But if your system becomes complex enough, you'll need to go through the more general framework instead, and that framework is called CodeLab. But that's a subject for another video. If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.